Venant de cette matinée, M. Tionyang, vous avez un parcours, j'ai envie de dire, un peu atypique. Vous êtes né au Sénégal, vous vivez aux États-Unis. Vous êtes le président et le fondateur de Give One Project pour l'engagement et le progrès des jeunes leaders. Alors, vous avez travaillé avec Barack Obama pour la campagne électorale. Et vos valeurs sont le leadership, la participation civique et citoyenne. Je crois que c'est quelque chose sur lequel vous voulez beaucoup insister ce matin. À vous.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Thank you, President Gattaz, for this invitation to come to Paris and speak with this audience. Thank you for your leadership, and I want to also thank your staff and ask everyone to join me in thanking you for such a great job they've done in organizing this successful event. It is a great pleasure and an honor to be here today in this room with, I will say, the heart of the economy of France. Many of you are heads of companies from small to large enterprises. And I can't be in a better room to talk about the world that's changing, le monde qui bouge. In the United States, 2 days ago, before I got here, in the steps of the Lincoln Memorial, President Obama, President Clinton, and President Carter spoke eloquently of the dream of Dr. Martin Luther King in commemoration of the 50th anniversary of Dr. King. So I have a dream speech. The reason why I'm sharing that with you is because from that day, yes, just 2 days ago, again, I saw that change is possible. That I saw, yes, our world has moved this past few years in our decades, in our time. If a young man less than 40 years old can have a dream just 50 years ago that black people like me couldn't vote or even participate in the electoral process, and today, 50 years later, a black president is reminding us that dream is possible, I'm here to tell you that the world is changing. But I'm also here to tell you that the world has to change a little bit more. We got a lot more work to do. Because if we have 3 billion people around the world today and you have 13.1% of those people are in poverty today. Unfortunately, 925 million people are dying every year of hunger. Yes, we have a lot of more work to do. That world is changing. It's not changing for those particular people. That world is not changing for those millions of people today will not be able to have lunch when you and I are going to break out and have lunch and talk to each other and have lunch and share each other's business cards. That world is not changing for them. But believe it or not, we do better when we all do well. And the United States issues a few years ago reminded us that when the economy collapsed in America, it touched France, it touched Africa, it touched Senegal, it touched everywhere in the world, which is showing us today that the world is interconnected. We are not alone in this world, and we cannot continue to keep ignoring the other anymore. Because if you do well, and we all do well together, but if few do well, believe me, you're not going to do well for a long time, because it's going to last. It's not going to last. So what I'm trying to tell you today is because I came to France in this particular country a few years ago, and when I go to these quartiers, these neighborhoods, these young people, the young born French, and cannot find jobs in these countries, and also they went to school, you invested in their schools, you invested in their education, and unfortunately, if you go to Miami, I went to Miami, I found young French people over there looking for work. I go to Canada, I find young French people over there looking for work. I went to Philippines, like you're talking about, in Dubai, in Abu Dhabi, in Doha. Now in Africa, finding young French people looking for work. Why? It's because they cannot find a job in their own country. Why? It's because and sometimes they're not finding a job because they don't have the ability or the skills that's needed. Some of them have PhDs, 2 or 3 degrees. Everything society asks them to do, they've done it. But unfortunately, they happen to have a wrong color in their country, or unfortunately, they happen to have a name, Mamadou or Fatou or Ibrahim, then the companies are not hiring them. This is not the world that's changing. And guess what? If we don't hire them here in France, other countries will take advantage of them. They will make sure they take care of them. And some of those young people are doing what you ask them to do. I'm very proud when I sat earlier and sat here and listened to Bernard Lamont, a hero in France, in his generation, who went to sweat, fought hard to defend the colors of his country, to bring the championship of the world in France. People like that need to be celebrated. In the United States of America, I was not born in that country. I just went to America in 2000 with nothing but $20 in my pocket. I came from poverty in Senegal with a family of 28 brothers and sisters. I just had a dream that one day I just wanted to go to America so I can have a better life for my family. When I went to America, from 2000 today, it's only 13 years. I went on from cleaning tables to going to school, and America gave me the shot to do everything that I dreamed of doing until working with the President of the United States of America. If the United States can give me that, young people should have the same chance everywhere. They should. They should have that same opportunity everywhere, because believe it or not, each one of you here, you want the same thing that I've had in the United States for your children. And what I want for my son, the 8-year-old in the United States, El Haji, I want for everybody's son. I want a better world for the next generations to come. This is why I'm fighting every single day through my organization, the Give One Project, in 17 countries now, here in France, that I'm taking young people from France, give them leadership trainings and helping them on entrepreneurship training so they can come back here in France and help participate to what can move their country forward. And we are doing that around in 17 countries. What President Obama told us that I just want to remind us real quickly is that focusing your life solely on making a buck shows a certain poverty of ambition. It asks too little of yourself. Because it's only when you hitch your wagon to something larger than yourself that you realize your true potential. The reason why I brought this quote is something. Each one of us here tonight is going to be remembered or not. The reason why we remember people like De Gaulle, President De Gaulle, the reason why we remember people like Dr. Martin Luther King, the reason why history always remember people like Kennedy and Gandhi, it's not about how much, because they made so much money. It's not about how many millions that they collected in the duration of their life, because believe it or not, we're all here in a very temporary time. They remember us today is because of what they've done to move the world better, what they've done to make life better for others. And this is our calling for our generation. So we have an obligation to move the world, to make the world le monde qui bouge. Because for now, it's not moving, if that's a world. And for that, please give an opportunity to those people who need it. Please uplift others. Participate in giving others another opportunity. Because in the end, that's all that will matter. We will make the next generations, your children, your grandchildren, and my children, their life better if we make other people's lives better, if we make the world better. France is not going to be better if Africa is at war. Because if you want to see it, when Africa is difficult, those young people are taking the pirogues to come here. And it's making your life a little harder. So let's make sure that we be each other's keepers so we can make the world better, and hopefully we can make our countries better, and we can make all of our neighborhoods, whether you are black, you are white, you are in the quartiers, or you are in the residential areas, we all, not only you are not French only, but we are humankind, and we have an obligation to make this world a better place for not only us, but for our children. God bless you all, and thank you for listening to me.
Alors Tian, bonjour.
Bonjour.
Tu publies tes mémoires, Mémoires d'un éternel optimiste.
Voilà.
À quel âge déjà?
Ouais, 37 ans aujourd'hui, 37 ans cette année.
C'est pas un peu tôt pour publier des mémoires?
Non, je pense que c'est jamais tôt. C'est jamais tôt de partager ces expériences pour pouvoir inspirer nos jeunes frères et sœurs, qui je sais, il y en a tellement qui sont en train de vivre les mêmes obstacles, problèmes et difficultés que par exemple que moi j'ai vécu et comment je fais ce que je fais. Je l'ai écrit parce que je voulais inspirer ces jeunes-là qui sont dans ces moments que, pour leur dire que c'est possible, pour leur dire qu'il y a ce qu'on appelle les Américains de light at the end of the tunnel, il y a possibilité. Si on continue à croire, si on continue à se battre, il y a la réussite après ça. Mais c'est juste de réussir. C'est plus quand on partage cette réussite, cette expérience avec les autres pour qu'on puisse les aider à faire plus qu'on a fait. C'est la raison pour laquelle je l'ai écrit très tôt. Je ne voulais pas attendre à l'âge de 67 ans, 77 ans pour écrire le livre. Parce que là, je pense que j'aurais oublié quelques anecdotes que j'ai pu utiliser aujourd'hui qui sont fraîches. Je viens de sortir de ces anecdotes. Par exemple, ma rencontre avec le président Obama, mon travail avec le Democratic Party, mes débuts aux États-Unis, mais aussi au début au Sénégal, ma culture, la famille, aussi mes valeurs au Sénégal, quitter le Sénégal pour aller à la recherche de l'inconnu que je ne connaissais pas. Et ce que j'ai pu apprendre tout au long de ça, je puis partager sur le livre.
S'il y avait un seul message que les lecteurs doivent retenir de ce livre, ce serait lequel?
Optimisme. Optimisme. C'est pourquoi j'ai choisi le titre Mémoire d'un éternel optimiste. Il faut être optimistique, il faut être optimiste, il faut croire en soi.
Il ne faut pas se décourager, il faut continuer à se battre. Il faut aussi travailler dur et ne pas lâcher, même quand parfois c'est difficile, c'est presque... tu ne vois pas la lumière, hein, c'est un peu sombre. Mais tout ce que je dis à la jeunesse du monde entier, c'est que l'optimisme, ça paye. Ça paye, il faut rêver grand, il faut travailler, mais aussi il faut croire en soi et de ne pas lâcher. C'est mon message partout où je vais. On a tous quelque chose à apporter dans le monde. Au début, je voulais un changement pour ma famille, je voulais aider la famille. C'est ce qui m'a poussé à sortir pour le pays. Et après, j'ai eu la chance de côtoyer les grands du monde entier, de travailler avec des gens avec qui j'ai jamais même imaginé les rencontrer. Et ça m'a montré que tout est possible si on veut un rêve et on veut travailler pour réaliser ses rêves. Donc c'est ce même message que je donne à la jeunesse, c'est ce livre. C'est pas pour juste écrire l'histoire de Chan Yang, chacun a une histoire. Hein. Il y en a tellement de millions de Chan Yang en France et aussi dans les autres pays. Mais moi j'ai choisi d'écrire mon histoire pour pouvoir encore encourager la jeunesse, pour leur dire que voilà, je l'ai fait, vous aussi vous pouvez le faire. Pas seulement vous pouvez le faire, mais vous pouvez faire plus que nous.
Votre message ressemble beaucoup à celui d'Obama. Hein?
Tous les messages positifs se ressemblent. Celle d'Obama est la même chose que le message de Nelson Mandela. C'est la même chose, c'est le même message de Gandhi, de Dr. King, de nos leaders qu'on a eu en Afrique, mais aussi aux États-Unis. Parce que ce qui est positif, c'est la même chose. On est différents par nos cultures. But the center, c'est la même chose.
Est-ce que le risque aujourd'hui, en publiant ces mémoires, c'est pas de dormir sur vos lauriers, de vous dire que vous avez déjà tout obtenu, il n'y a plus rien à faire, il n'y a plus d'efforts à fournir?
Non, c'est le début, c'est ce que j'ai eu à la fin du livre. Que ces anecdotes, que je réfléchisse, qui se sont passées des années juste passées, me donnent encore l'énergie de créer d'autres énergies, quelque part, de ça. Parce que si vous voyez aujourd'hui ce qui s'est passé dans le premier ouverture de mon livre, aujourd'hui, les jeunes qui témoignent, vous avez vu, j'ai investi sur eux, ça fait presque 4 ans, 5 ans. Mais maintenant, ils ont commencé à être des chefs d'entreprise, des politiciens, des journalistes, des banquiers. Et je suis très touché aujourd'hui de les entendre parler de comment notre organisation a changé leur vie. Et ils sont en train de créer de l'emploi dans leur pays. Ils croient en eux parce que je n'ai plus de rien de leur faire rencontrer les top leaders du monde entier pour leur inspirer, pour leur dire que, attends, Obama est un être humain comme vous. Il a rêvé, il l'a fait, vous aussi, vous pouvez le faire. Je suis amené à l'Élysée, dans les institutions, les plus grandes institutions du monde entier, les Nations Unies partout. Donc, je dis ça pour vous dire que pour certains, c'est tôt d'écrire ces mémoires. Mais pour moi, j'aime aller à ce qu'on appelle « against the odds ». Aller là où c'est pas, les gens ne vont pas souvent. Et là, c'est là où tu veux
sortir des chantiers battus.
Il faut sortir de ça. Et je pense que si on écrit très tôt et très souvent, on donne la chance à la jeunesse aussi de voir et de critiquer, de pouvoir discuter de ça. Et tu es là pour aussi échanger avec eux de ces expériences. À l'âge de 80 ans, je n'aurai pas assez d'énergie pour voyager le monde. Et sans jouer avec eux, je suis là, demain je vais à Genève, après Canada, États-Unis, j'ai une vingtaine de pays que je dois voyager à rencontrer la jeunesse du monde entier.
Quand vous publiez un livre comme celui-là, ça met plein d'étoiles dans les yeux des jeunes autres Africains et ça rejoint un peu le message qui est général sur l'Afrique aujourd'hui, qui consiste à dire c'est la prochaine frontière, l'Afrique est la prochaine frontière. Vous aussi, vous y croyez ou vous...
Je le crois pas seulement, je le vis. L'Afrique, c'est pas la prochaine frontière, c'est la frontière d'aujourd'hui. Hein. Nous, on ne croit pas à ce qu'on nous dise que c'est demain l'Afrique, c'est aujourd'hui. Vous voyez ce qu'on est en train de faire en Afrique avec notre énergie solaire, Ekan et moi. On n'attend pas que demain pour le faire. Le malheur qu'on a, parce qu'on n'a pas assez de médias qui focus sur ce qui est positif en Afrique. Souvent, ils nous montrent le côté négatif. Mais il y a de belles histoires qui se créent aujourd'hui en Afrique. Et je suis très optimiste pour notre continent, pour sa jeunesse, pour son peuple qui sont en train de se lever, sa diaspora qui sont en train de revenir et amener leur pierre à l'édifice pour ce qui va continuer à construire cette Afrique que nous rêvions chaque jour, que je vois moi très proche, qui sera là pour nos enfants et pour leur génération, pour là, ils seront fiers d'être africains. Le monde est en train de tourner vers l'Afrique, mais nous, on s'est levé déjà avant ça. Et on croit à ça. Et moi, je crois pas à ce développement de l'Afrique où ils nous donnent des chiffres pour nos pays qu'on a 12-15% of growth, par exemple. Et tu vois, en Afrique, tu vois que la population ne touche pas ça. C'est quelques investisseurs qui viennent, qui font des milliards, mais à la fin, on a toujours des problèmes basiques comme l'énergie et l'eau. Et ça, c'est pas le côté développement pour moi. Moi, ce que je crois, c'est que les Africains eux-mêmes, comme nous, la jeunesse africaine, nous avons voyagé le monde, on a compris ce qui se passe, on a appris, on a pu observer de l'autre côté ce qui se passe. On est en train de ramener ça chez nous, pour, avec ce qu'on a chez nous, recréer l'histoire de l'Afrique. Et ça dépendra des enfants de l'Afrique, comme tous les Africains qui sont en dehors du pays et ceux qui sont dedans, de retourner avec nos partenaires, of course, chinois, américains, japonais, européens. Welcome, because we welcome everybody. But in the end, à la fin, c'est nous, on doit développer chez nous. L'Europe a été développée par les Européens eux-mêmes, les États-Unis par les Américains eux-mêmes. Ils ont des partenaires, of course, mais c'est eux-mêmes qui l'ont fait. Le Middle East, ils l'ont fait la même chose, Emirates Arabes. China, la même chose. Et l'Afrique, on n'a plus besoin d'aide. On doit changer ce paradigme pour que nous, Africains, on développe notre continent et que quiconque vient en Afrique, ça va être partnership, win-win situation. And this is coming, is today. Parce que l'Africain que tu vois aujourd'hui, il n'est pas complexé. Il n'a pas ce problème de difference of culture, difference of language. Ce n'est pas cet Africain. L'Africain que tu vois aujourd'hui, c'est la jeunesse africaine qui a voyagé le monde, qui comprend ce qui se passe, qui parle les langues, qui a des diplômes, qui a vu tout ce qu'on doit voir et qui aime son continent et qui est de retour pour changer son continent. Et ça, c'est des milliers d'Africains comme moi qui sont en train de le faire, comme Tony Elemolu au Nigeria, qui de tout donner $100 millions pour l'entrepreneurship des jeunes Africains. Pour la Maison Blanche, ils ont commencé avec 500 personnes. Lui, il a commencé avec 10 000 jeunes Africains avec $100 millions cash sur la table. Ça, c'est extraordinaire. Un jeune comme Akon qui sort de n'importe où, avec moi et lui, Samba Bachili, $1.2 billion of energy en Afrique. 5 000 et quelques jeunes qui sont en train de travailler sur le terrain. Et on vient de lancer, le mois passé, notre énergie solaire, Académie énergie solaire au Mali, pour former la jeunesse africaine, pour que ce transfert of knowledge, on vient toujours de l'autre côté pour le faire. Nous, les jeunes Africains, on le fait pour nos jeunes frères et sœurs. Et ça, tu peux multiplier partout. Les jeunes comme Yusundu, c'est partout. Ils le font pour le continent. L'Afrique s'est levée finalement.
D'accord. Alors, le livre sort en France. Il sort en français et en anglais.
Oui.
Quand est-ce que les Africains pourront sur le continent l'avoir en main?
Les Africains, ils vont l'avoir dans un mois. Et c'est sorti ici en France aujourd'hui. Mais jusqu'à aujourd'hui, ils peuvent même l'avoir sur Amazon. Amazon.com ou Amazon.fr ou UAE, England, partout online, ils peuvent l'avoir. Et au Sénégal, ce sera dans presque un mois. Et États-Unis aussi dans 2 semaines. Mais ce sera disponible pour tout le monde. Ne vous inquiétez pas. C'est fait pour la jeunesse du monde entier.
D'accord. Un dernier mot par rapport à ce livre en direction des lecteurs qui l'auront en main ou qui souhaiteraient l'avoir en main.
Écoutez, je veux juste dire que sur ce livre, vous verrez que beaucoup de jeunes vont se reconnaître sur ça. J'en suis certain. Il y a beaucoup de jeunes qui vont se reconnaître, qui ont eu le même parcours. Il y a des milliers de jeunes africains aujourd'hui, même du monde entier, hein, qui vivent sur la polygamie. Parce que le livre parle d'un jeune de Kaolack qui a grandi en polygamie, que beaucoup de nous en Afrique, on connaît bien. Avec ça, il a eu des rêves pour faire quelque chose pour sa famille, pour sa maman, ce qui était presque impossible. Il a quitté sa ville natale pour aller à la capitale, à la recherche de cette opportunité pour aider sa mère. Et finalement, il a tapé des portes, il a voyagé, il s'est battu seul pour aller aux États-Unis avec $20 en poche, dans un pays où il ne comprenait pas la langue, mais qu'il voyageait pour une ouverture qu'il ne comprenait pas, c'était quoi, l'inconnu. Par les Potubilo, il a commencé jusqu'à, avec toutes les difficultés que c'était, comme tous les immigrés, il a écrit son propre histoire. Et avec ça, il a rencontré, par hasard, le premier président noir des États-Unis avec qui il a travaillé depuis 2006-2007. Et heureusement, il est devenu président, le gars. Après, il a travaillé avec lui et ça a changé sa vie. Et il retourne maintenant, il redonne espoir à la jeunesse africaine et du monde entier, parce que Give One Project, son organisation, est dans 30 pays du monde entier, même en Arabie Saoudite, au Japon, aux États-Unis. Pour dire à cette jeunesse-là, vous aussi, vous pouvez le faire. Ce que j'ai fait, ce n'est pas un miracle. Eux, ils peuvent faire beaucoup plus. Moi, je juste contribue sur ce que je peux pour donner un peu d'encouragement et d'optimisme et de pont que je n'avais pas, ces bridges de connexion que je suis en train de créer pour ces jeunes Français, ces jeunes Arabes, ces jeunes Américains, ces jeunes musulmans, ces jeunes chrétiens, ces jeunes Africains qui sont comme moi. Et aujourd'hui, ce réseau est atteint. Voilà, c'est ce que je dis sur le livre. Et j'espère que ça peut encourager les jeunes, parce que c'est le but que j'ai, c'est pourquoi j'ai partagé ces mémoires très personnelles. À la jeunesse du monde.
Juste une dernière question. Le drame des migrants que l'on vit aujourd'hui sur les côtes de la Méditerranée, qu'est-ce que vous en pensez?
C'est écœurant. Écœurant, ça me touche énormément, parce que c'est mes frères et sœurs qui sont en train de mourir chaque jour. Des jeunes que l'Afrique a besoin aujourd'hui. On a besoin de ces jeunes pour construire notre continent. Et malheureusement, il n'y a pas assez de... Il n'y a pas assez de hope pour eux. Et quand il n'y a pas de hope, ils vont créer leur propre hope. Ils vont espérer de l'autre côté. Ils pensent que c'est en Europe. Donc ils prennent les bateaux pour risquer leur vie pour venir ici. Parfois, est-ce que tu peux les blâmer? Si tu n'as rien à manger, tu n'as rien à perdre. Et tu regardes la télé, Facebook, le monde aujourd'hui est interconnecté. Tu vois leurs amis, friends qui sont sur Internet, partout, dans tous les pays du monde entier qui sont bien, ou prétendent être bien. Et eux, comme je vivais moi, parfois de 3-4 jours, je n'ai pas quelque chose à manger. Heureusement, je n'ai pas pris les pirogues. Mais eux, ils prennent les pirogues parce qu'ils n'ont pas le choix. Ils veulent aider la mère, maman, comme moi, je voulais aider ma mère. Mais ils n'ont personne pour les aider. Le gouvernement ne donne pas, ne crée pas des policies nécessaires pour leur donner ces opportunités. C'est pourquoi ça m'écarte, parce qu'il n'y a pas un pays qui peut développer sans sa jeunesse. Donc même si notre continent est aujourd'hui debout, sans cette jeunesse formée, avec espoir, je ne pense pas qu'on peut le faire. Pourquoi ne sait que le travail qu'on est en train de faire est vraiment important pour nous, parce qu'il faut donner espoir à la jeunesse. Il faut leur montrer qu'ils peuvent le faire chez nous. Parce qu'il y a des jeunes Africains qui n'ont pas sorti et ils l'ont fait. Et je parle de ça d'ailleurs dans le livre. Que ces jeunes Africains qui n'ont pas pu sortir et qui ont réussi là-bas nous ont donné tort, nous. Parce que nous, on pensait que la réussite, c'était d'or. Heureusement qu'après la réussite, on retourne au pays pour investir et donner cette chance à la jeunesse, pour leur dire qu'on peut le faire ici. Regardez un président comme le président Macky Sall qui n'a jamais quitté le pays. Il a étudié chez Anta Diop University. Aujourd'hui, il est président de la République. Donc, il y a des exemples. Businessmen qui le font aussi. Donc, je parle de ça dans mon livre. Et il faut qu'on trouve des solutions immédiates. Vraiment immédiat. J'étais en Gambie l'autre jour pour lancer le Give One Project et ma conférence était sur ça. 500 jeunes qui sont sortis et tout le monde me dit que chacun a un frère et soeur qui est aujourd'hui parti, on ne sait pas il est où. Et c'est catastrophique. Voilà.
Merci beaucoup.
Merci.
team for inviting me to be here. My name is John Nyang. I am originally from Senegal. I live in Washington, D.C. You know, a few years back, in the 50s, towards the 60s, there was young people like me who grew up in this continent and who saw that something needed to be done to move Africa in a different generation, in a different direction. Those were just young people who were dreaming that someday they will be able to liberate their countries. In this great nation, we have our father, Madiba Nelson Mandela, who at a very young age joined the ANC movement at 26 years old. Not very far from here in Ghana, Nkrumah was just 35 when he joined the Pan-African movement. In countries like Singapore, Lee Kuan Yew took over the country after Malaysia separation and Singapore at 36 years old. In the United States, Thomas Jefferson wrote the Constitution of the United States at age 35. Why am I saying these ages? There is something in young people always being at the center stage of change. And they've done what they were supposed to do to give me an opportunity here in Africa today to challenge the status quo, but also in the United States for me to be where I am there today and coming back home to make a difference is because somebody has made a sacrifice. Somebody has done something to create a space for me today. So for young people like me in our generation today, our calling is not to liberate Africa as Nelson Mandela done it, as Nkrumah, as Leopold Sedar Senghor, and etc. But our calling today is to make sure the inequality in this continent, and the gaps, the poverty, and the lack of opportunities of our young people are closed. And nobody is going to come to do it for us. We got a role to play, young people in the diaspora, but also young people in the continent. This is why Akon and I, my partner, and Samba Bachili got together in 2013 and launched Akon Lighting Africa. Why Akon Lighting Africa? Because I grew up in Kaolack, Senegal, as he said, in a family of 28 brothers and sisters in poverty, sometimes 4 days in the house with no food. This was the conditions I grew upon, where my grandfather was to wake us up very early in the morning so we can study or do our homeworks that we can finish the night before because the sun went down just a little early. And in 2013, when I invited Akon to come to the White House through my nonprofit organization, I do global leadership program, mentoring young people on entrepreneurship every year in Washington. I bring 200 young Africans there. And Akon was the special guest. And he was very inspired at the work that we're doing. So Akon asked me, what do we need to do to help the continent? And I remembered those days where our house, we never had electricity growing up, till I went to America at 22. I said, I want to start somewhere in energy. Because I know today, 600 million Africans are living in the dark. And if we don't do something, nothing will happen. If you go home tonight and you switch the light at your house and it doesn't come, you'll probably be shocked because we are the fortunate ones. But I'm here to tell you that I've traveled around the continent from north to south in 5 villages everywhere in the continent. And there are those people who just will never know what electricity is about. Forget about internet and connectivity. They just cannot even have, you know, a light at home so somebody, their children, can be able just to study. How those young people can compete with the young men and women who are sitting in Washington, D.C., in Boston, in Singapore, and in France, in Europe, and other countries. We cannot talk about the development of Africa until we tackle the education issues and accessibility to energy. This is the cornerstone of our development. Because these young people will never be able to compete internationally. This is why we're investing in energy. And it's been challenging, it's been fascinating at the same time, as our lives has changed throughout this process. Today, we're in 17 countries in the continent and aiming to be in 44 countries in the next 5 years. 5,400 young people, young Africans, are helping us. We hired to work for us, and all of them went through our academy. In the first year, we went to China because we have a $1 billion line of credit to do this work. In every country we come in, we come with our pre-financing. When we went to China, our partners told us that every country we're going to bring 100 to 200 people to do the work. I said to Akon, we cannot do that. We need a country manager and a quality control manager, and the rest, they help us train our young people, that they will help us to install these lights and do the maintenance. Because last year, 1,500 young Africans died underwater trying to cross between Morocco and Libya to go to Europe looking for opportunities. If we don't give these young people opportunities, who will? From that meeting, we launched the first solar academy in the continent in Mali. And now we are training these young people who are doing, when they finish, we're hiring them directly to do the work for us throughout the continent. This work is important. And I know many of you in your area, you're doing the work that's necessary to help elevate the continent. It is unequal. We talk about always growth and GDP growth. And when I go around these villages, I'm not sure if these people feel the growth and the GDPs of what's happening in these huge conferences, in our offices. The majority of Africans do not feel it. And it's our responsibility, us Africans, and our partners in it, because we need everybody to be able to bring this continent where it needs to be. But even through our partners, it has to be now a new generation that will say, you know what, this partnership will have to be a win-win partnership. Because somehow, in where I live in America, America partners with the rest of the world, but America comes first. And somehow in Africa, we are a little shy, especially our governments, to put Africa first. And this belongs to Africans to do that. So all of the young Africans that are here today, we have a responsibility. In years from now, another generation will come, and questions will be asked. And we will have to answer some questions to what we have done to make life better for those young people that will come and will be sitting to where we are today. I don't know what will you answer, but I know what I want to answer, that I want that Africa to be for them. I want an Africa where every young person will have the same opportunity like my son Elhaja in the United States, can go to the same school and find a computer that they can connect to, have access to internet that we're talking about today, be able to build applications, be able to build those computers, Mr. Minister, that you're talking about, not for them to build it for us to bring it here, but our children here in Africa to build it for us and for our kids. This is the Africa that I want. And this is the Africa that we're working on every single day, and we're inviting each and every one of you, especially the diaspora that are watching. Because everything we've learned around the world It's time that we bring it so it can benefit our people. Whom much is given, much is required. And I will close to say to you that every generation at one point has to ask, what is your calling? The most pressing questions. What will you leave behind and how you will be remembered? Not only the generation, but each and one of us should answer that question. What will we leave here when we leave Earth that we will be remembered? Because Nelson Mandela, from this great country, we know what he represents. Forever he will live here. People like Dr. King, who's fought through the civil rights movement, has allowed people like Barack Obama and myself from Kowloon to do what I'm doing in America today. But who are we and what are we going to leave? So Africa will be not only be for numbers and statistics and a place where we come and do business and get back to the plan and take everything back out, where our children cannot even have a clean water to drink, cannot have access to electricity, cannot have decent education, cannot have the minimum that is needed to be able to compete globally. If we cannot answer these questions, tomorrow when generations ask, we will fail them. So thank you for listening, and thank you for being here. God bless you all.
We're getting there. If you have a sharp eye, you will notice in the program of VivaTech this year, all across the board, we have a special stage for Tech at Africa. This morning, President Kagame of Africa was here with President Macron. And we have the, it's not up on the board yet, but we have what you're about to hear now, an interesting roundtable about the situation of Africa and technology and what's happening, what's not happening, and the whole question of whether it can, how technology in Africa will develop. That's not an accident. One of the big sponsors of VivaTech, you will also notice if you are careful, is Orange, the big global telephone company, which just happens to be very interested in Africa, and Stéphane Richard, the CEO, is personally interested in it. So we have a kind of interesting confluence. And Orange came to us this year and said, could you please increase the Africa component in the programming? And so I think, are we all set? Let's bring them out. There we go. Thank you very much. Fabienne Schmidt at the end, who is the high-tech and media reporter for Les Echos, is going to be leading the discussion, and she will introduce the panelists. So without further ado, Roundtable Tech for Africa. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Fabienne Schmidt. I'm chief of the high-tech and media section of for the daily economic newspaper Les Echos in France. So we're here to talk about Tech for Africa. And as you probably know, Africa is one of the main topics of this third edition of VivaTech. You can see Africa everywhere at the show. We have here 100 African startups And several countries like Morocco or Tunisia have their own pavilion here at VivaTech. With 300 innovation centers in its 54 countries, Africa has the potential to become one of the next hubs of global innovation. Africa Tech is actually booming, and the continent is today a kind of new digital frontier driven by digital natives, 995 million mobile subscribers, and 362 million of internet users. So we're going to speak about the tech ecosystem in Africa, about innovation, of course, and how startups find funding. And the question is also, what will be the next evolution in Africa, and who will lead it? So to answer those questions, I'm with Stéphane Richard, chairman and CEO of Orange, Emrod Abdella, regional director of 4Africa Initiative for Microsoft, Sina Lawson, Minister of Ports and Digital Economy for the Government of Togo, and Chun Nyang, author, social entrepreneur, and political strategist. So we'll begin with you, Stéphane Richard. Orange is present in 18 countries in Africa. And this is a place where you help startups and where you have 120 million customers. So how would you describe the tech landscape in Africa? Would you say, for example, that there is a real ecosystem, a real African ecosystem?
Well, the first thing probably to say about Africa is that it is a connected continent today. If you take the mobile penetration, it is twice higher in Africa than in India, for instance. So, to some extent, Africa is already a connected continent. Of course, there is still some infrastructure to build. We have also to get some smartphones at a price that will enable the digitization to spread much more in Africa. But it's a very good start and a very good situation today to contemplate a very promising future. Now, regarding regarding tech, we have very interesting things, especially because there is a number of areas where digital tools can provide really game-changing solutions to development issues, like education, like agriculture, like e-commerce, like content, and a number of other things. So we see today a number of startups in Africa. The quantity of capital that is invested in the tech in Africa is still too small. Mm-hmm. It's in a range of $400 million today. Mm-hmm. I think we can do much more. That is the reason why Orange has decided to first identify and coach startups in Africa through acceleration programs called Orange Fab. Today we have more than 30 startups within our Orange Fab programs in Africa. Second, we have decided also to open a special corporate fund, Orange Digital Ventures for Africa, with 50 million as a first step. Mm-hmm. And what we want to do clearly is to be one of the players, as a telco, of course, but also as an investor, to really promote innovation, identify, help, open doors to startups. We see a growing number of young entrepreneurs, a growing number of young people having great ideas, and there is still a lot of things to do in areas like e-commerce, for instance, where Africa is probably less advanced than other areas in the world. So for us, it's clearly one of our priorities to invest in innovation.
What do you think, Chun Yang, about this landscape? In Africa, you are an entrepreneur yourself. How do you explain there's this boom of startups in Africa?
Well, thank you. This boom of startups in Africa is a response to Africans finding solutions of some of the biggest problems that we have in the continent. Africa today is in the crossroads. Our generation understand today the need to find solutions that we've been fighting with for a long time. Just like Europe after the World War, where you had the Industrial Revolution, where young Europeans from across this continent had to face some of the biggest challenges across the world to rebuild their nations.
People say that
here,
when you have there is a problem in Africa, there's always a solution,
and that's
there's
I'm
always
to.
A startup behind. Is that true?
That's where I'm coming into. And today, for a very long time after independence, our founding fathers have created an opportunity for us, the new generation, has passed us the torch. And today we have the greatest opportunity here with technology to transform drastically Africa. That's why you see many things is happening through leapfrogging. The things that we didn't know in America, in France, in other countries about technology is happening in Kenya with M-Pesa. It's happening in my home country, like Wari, a young Senegalese, creating opportunities to the smallest, remotest villages to make sure that people like us, the farmers, I am a farmer through Jeff Zorn of my project, where today farmers had problems to just have access to the market. But now from my farm and farmers around me, they can just buy through Orange with the technology, with our telephones, or through Wari with mobile technologies from their telephones. They can bank through their telephones. And this is not only on the areas of farming, but also on education, as he said, on the health systems, and also on governments and policies that's helping us today to transform the continent. This is in response to what you're asking about, a time for everyone here who's thinking about coming to Africa and investing in Africa. This is the greatest time that you can have to have the greatest returns, just like companies like Orange is doing in the continent. It is a remarkable continent. A lot of things is happening today, and it's not going to stop. It's going to continue to move forward because you have a diaspora and a new generation that travel the world that understand what it takes to change the continent. Before I give you the mic, though, I will just say quickly, for everyone coming to invest in Africa, just like you guys in Europe and in America, when you're transforming your continents, you need outsiders, you need opportunities, you need partners to come and help. We too need supporters. We need partners from Europe, from America, from Asia to come in and support what we're trying to do in the continent. But I just say that we need it in the level where it can be a win-win situation. I don't think it's allowed anymore in Africa where it's that time is gone where you can just come do Africa and do business in Africa in any kind of way. Do business in Africa with no social responsibilities. We're not being able to follow the rules as we do in so many African countries. Those days are gone. It's a new Africa. It's a new generation that understands exactly what it takes to transform our countries and solve the problems that we have. And we need it with you in a win-win situation. Thank you.
Ñi fi ci walo Sénégal ci Jeff Zone Farm ci nord suñu dëkk bi digënté Sénégal ak Mauritanie ñi ngi fi bay ciép ci tool bi lañ doon visiter ci ni suñu tool ciép bi puisque côté ñaay bi Jeff Zone tool bu ñëkk bi ñi ngi doon bay fofu ñi ba légui ñi ngi fay bay maraîchage lañu def fofu ay légumes donc def nañ ñaarëm ñi ngi fay bay dugub ak mbokk salum ñi ngi fay def dugub ak mbokk ak à Gaté. Donc nous décidons aussi le nord du pays ñu bay liñ wax ciép bi nga xamné dañ koy consommer mais ñu consommer ko lo xamné ñu koy consommer suñu bop diko bayal suñu bop moy ciébu local bi té fi ni ngi ko gissé tool yépp am nañ ndox liñu manké du ndox tool yi dafa plat ñu dem ci biir sax mo won la ngeen gissal seen bop kay bismillah xol leen ñëmel gis nga fi yépp ndox la té ndox mi mi ngi jogé ci ndoxu dex gi digënté ñun wa li dem nak tol ci mom bo fu ñëwé ñi lay démé quoi d'accord wa ñu ñëli yépp nga gis ndox la bam pès del mais lepp lo fi gis ciéb la d'accord yépp on a fait du riz partout. Tolu ciab la fi ndox ma ngi fi les terres sont plates ñi ngi ni entre digënté Mauritanie ak Sénégal fleuve mi ngi suñu digënté dem na Indonésie dem na Malaisie dem na fi ñu jëlé suñu ciab bi ci biir Bali ñom ci ay montagne lañuy bayé pour am ciab.
Yeah, you did.
You do first. You stay first. Then cut in the rice. Come closer.
Be careful your feet, Hassan.
Yeah, and go. Right there.
Be careful your feet, yeah.
Yeah, so this is here.
Rice.
The rice we eat everywhere, especially in my country, is coming right from here in these fields.
Mm-hmm.
In the rice fields. And these are the guys, all the people that are making it happen here. That's why we make sure to see the process, how it works. I'm here in Indonesia, in Bali. Thank you so much for what you do. Maybe the work you do here is being enjoyed in my place, in my hometown. You know, tell them that. Tell them the rice we eat at home.
Di Senegal yang makan rice kini masih patok
katanya. Oh, and sometimes it come from here.
Yeah.
You know?
Kadang-kadang yang import pun ada yang Indonesia rice.
Right. And you can see how muddy it is over here. And that's how they're making it. It's all the ladies.
Ñun on a tout. Xolal ndox da fi fess del. Fo tourne ndox la. Mais ba tay man mënuma comprendre ñi jox ceeb ñukoy lek bitim rew dañu ko indil. Man lolu dama ko def combat bo xamné suñu génération moko wara def. Parce que meun nañ def luñu bëgg infrastructure meun nañ def affaire santé meun mais yoy yëp fek amuñu contrôle luñuy lek on n'est pas indépendant ça dépend de nous boy nekk Dakar boy nekk ci ville boy liggéey
boy ci université même suñu rak yi ñiap ci tej leen doñ leen jox dara ñu bay leen ci café lañ leen indi ñu liggéey ñu leen di fay d'accord man ci lool la bëggu jeunesse bi ñu yewu ci parce que Afrique pour mu dox ñun ñoko wara doxal te pour mu dox ci liggéey lañ koy doxal lu ci wax ci jëf lay nekk voilà xolal tool yi légui ñun ñi fi commencé bay depuis 4 mois jëf zone riziculture ci tool yi fi est extraordinaire les résultats xol leen fi regarde tout ce que vous voyez c'est le riz 4 mois ngay def nga am ciep légui ñu fay ñu koy wowal né d'accord légui fini dess na tout ci côté bi yépp c'est jëf zone riziculture côté bi yépp c'est jëf zone bi yépp hein tout ça c'est les jeunes sénégalais qui croient à ce développement qui sont en train de m'aider pour changer ce qui se passe et c'est à nous de le faire qu'est-ce que nous le faire merci
dama fajeru dem tolay boru 5h 6h du matin buñu ñëwé bay gën dëkk bi ma gis une centaine de xalé yo xamné ñok suma doom ñoo massé ñi nga am ay 9 ans ni 10 ans ni 12 ans 14 ans etc ñu dox ci boru geej gi di continuer dem ci bir all bi ak sedd bi pour jangé affaire bi touché ma bu mënen lajé fu ñuy jangé ñu ne ma barñi ak ñun fiñ dëkk 4 km la ça veut dire dañuy dox 4 km pour yagg ci lëndëm gi ak ci sedd bi doxat 4 km an ci defat benen 4 km demane encore ak ngon suñu ñuar muy 16 km par jour journée bi yépp ma nekké tol ki rek may xalat ñu mëna apporter solution ci problème bu mel non parce que xam na né xalé yoyu tay ñoy nekk ëlëk njitu suñu dëkk yi suñu village yi suñu ville yi suñu réew mi Afrique ak aduna bi tout de suite bama ñëwé mo suñu maire bi fi ci dëkk bi pour ñu waxtaan pour trouver solution mais pas seulement trouver solution mais trouver solution rapidement parce que man je l'ai trouvé que les urgences la bo xamné dañ ko wara lëjënti parce que jeunesse bi faut ñu encadrer len pour ñu am éducation
man bi may ñëw en 2017 j'avais pensé à ce que tay ji de peut-être amu guñu sét mais buñu amone au moyen de transport bo xamantene mo ngi defal fi di len ñëw bu bo dina xaw soulager tout ça élève mais jusqu'à présent ça s'est pas réalisé
on peut trouver des solutions yo xamné ça sera partenaire public privé ou bien avec le public moy yene leader yi ñun en tant que citoyen parce que man Sénégal la jangé école publique comme yow cela dem mo nane def aussi 3 4 km par jour mais amna lo xamne mako war joxat sama rew de retour quoi tu vois donc wara ma nañ la gis waxtan ci auto bi mo won la ko ci souf
kelaw ma samba sin gis gam ko to sam
mi boye len dox bu ñuy dox ni man dem la ko bëgg
commencer
c'est trop ça il faut pas attendre
que leg na gëna metti sax
oui suñu mbéd mi dafay lendem ci kaw après port bi ni yeb c'est compliqué mom nañ gëna gaaw quoi 16 km par jour xalé bu ko dox bo yeggé do mëna jang parents d'élèves yi ma waxal yeb ak maire bi ñu ne ma bu xalé yeggé ak principal bi fofu bu ñu yexé ci école bi ñuy nelaw bu ñibisé duñu mëna jang sen leçon yi ndax dañuy sonn lolu ma tax majeur partie xalé yi nekk ci dëkk bi ñëpp dañuy bayyi jang ñen ñi nekk ci gëj gi wala ñi nekk ci focc gëj gi mënu mëna comprendre lolu ku amagul bac yow do tudé di Ousmane Fay 5ème Ousmane Fay 5ème Ousmane Fay 6ème takal Ousmane boss bu reul deng ko amagul bo reele sa boss bi nga ngi muñ da ngay dox de ni mo sama yono tour boy
quel numéro
c'est Difal
Salif
Salif
Fall
bari sante bi neex
regarde le neuf qui a cette il va faire une heure pour aller à l'école dina def une heure wati midi digante midi mu ñëwaat sen doit une heure wara gilat classe 3h
muy presque
4 heures de temps muy dox
wacce
pour dem école donc bu wacce du jang day sonne ci ba bu teulé même nalew yi da ngay dag parce que ñom man mo yow suma kër légui mon fils se lève à 4h30 du matin wala jox sangu bu féké né xal biñ bëgg jang dañuy tok lire tout di xaar sen morom yi génn donc day metti très difficile
motax xana lu motax boy bari baye jang bi
lutax lolu motax c'est vrai
ñom ñu
lolu motax boy yu bari a sen lu di arrêté ses parents yu mëna am moy boy dañuy son bu son té len di décourager dox di len décourager ñom ci mel jang préfère ñu baye ko
té buñ baye ko ils font quoi
ils vont à la pêche ils vont à la pêche
j'espère que
avec
ça va faire une petite
ouais, ça va faire
allez allez
le jour où la compagnie vraiment problème il faut le tuer donc ma mère nous top partenariat avec une given project la mairie de Sendou la population de Sendou nous trouver ensemble lo xamni ñun ñep comme mom pour que suñu doomi nek fi def len ci condition condition yi sama doom yi nek amerique nek ñun aussi ñu nek ci même condition yi manam bu ñu xeye bis jël len yobul len ñu jang ñu gon joté ñu indi wat len pour ñu mëna jang sen leçon yi parce que c'est un avenir de notre communauté ñu am ko len bac ñu senu ngeen def ba classe ndan nek len fonté ci suu
auto la yene ci baax
ah yene jitu yene ñu ko ñew auto d'accord mais am nga bac na nga koy jale d'accord ay yene tekki
d'accord ba ima
initiative bi ñu ngi koy rafetlu bu baaxa baax di leen gërëm di leen sante parce que li mom dañ sé contane ñun parents d'élèves yi di ñaax itamin ak suñu doom yi ñu jang ñu gor gorlu parce que li yag nañ ko wut waye amuñ ko won kon kat buñ ko amé nañu gor gorlu gëna gor gorlu ñom lay waxal duma wax ak borom auto de ñom ñi lay wax ñu gor gorlu bu baax jang
wa lool initiative bu baax la ñuy sante yalla rek lool lañ doon ñaan suñu doom yi dañoo doxo bu bëgga dé car bi mom bu amé mom sante yalla rek la alhamdullilah rabbil alamin lañuy wax mom yalla ko yalla yok bu mu yek ko ci barke sayidina muhammad suñu doomi dox nañ ba sonu fi mom dafa wara am sem wala mu am ay car yu len di duggal di len gene mais sen duggu bi genn na genn bi metti na waaw mom da mom ñu ngi sante yalla bu baaxa baax di sante cion ñaa bu baaxa baaxa baax yalla may ko fanu guddu ak wergu yaram wa salaam
li mom wax deug yalla dinañu neex torop bu ñeme ñuy jappale suñu doomi pour école bi mom bi na gëna neex torop parce que li dafa metti élève nga dug 6h du matin di dem jangi yo do am conscience tranquille do meuna jang say la so xolal bo ñew guddi yow choono bi day tax sa do xam dara déjà amna xalé yu bari abandoné ndax li sen parents amuñu moyen yo déjà da ngay inscrire nga joxe 10000 légui chaque jour nga wara jox xalé bi journée continue nga war ko jox lu mu añé ak ndekki bi bokul day xawa metti tay buñu amé transport bo xamné dañu yobbu xalé ñun dinañ ci content déjà sa doom day jang sa xel du dal
on a vraiment content de ce bus là parce que on se levait à 6h pour aller à l'école. Donc, Bisbini, arrange une intro.
Je suis en Sembani, je suis en classe de 6ème heure. Je suis en train de faire des choses pour arranger. Parce que nous avons fini, c'est très bon. Nous avons fait des choses pour nous faire des choses. Nous avons fait des choses pour nous faire des choses. Barni 1000 francs la mënu ñu ko fay suñu yaay def nañ ay arrangement yu bari ñu koy sante dal liko gëreum ñu koy encourager bu baax yalla ko yalla jëmmal kanam
auto bi la arrangement ay élèves yu bari bu baax parce que élèves dinañ dox fi ce jour suba tel dañuy dox dox ci gënde barni ce jour loolu mom arrangement ay élèves bu baax jonne ña amu frère bu suñu ñu ñëw seen fi ba tay gisal ni muy def fi auto bu mom amna amon ko fay naka yalla fay suba ci mbëw gëss ak wam met bi ñep japp na ci auto bi
par rapport ak li am ni mom sama xol sedd na ci trop parce que man dama daan jangi di doxé fi jogé sendu di dox ba barñi té lool nékkon na lu metti trop té ñu dem ba gis ku ci jappalé kon vraiment lool dañ ci sante yalla bu baax parce que man dama daan doxé fi bu ko sama morom daan dox 1h de temps mang kay dox 2h parce que sama tank dafa am fer daan ko mëna dox bu baax vraiment ci ñaan mom ñu koy remercier bu baax
mbolem problème yi ñi jang ko antel ci suñu community yi yep mën nañu trouver solution yi ensemble ci partenariat ci lankolo ci ligéyando ensemble lo xamné day nek rôle ñun ñep ci communauté bi ñi dëkk ci dëkk bi ñi ñu nek ci côté privé bi ak suñu maire yi way aussi ak suñu ngor yi buñu jappalanto ñun ñep ku nek yor indi lum yor ak population yi mën nañu continuer di trouver solution yu melni ci problème yi nga xamné ñun ñep ñoko bok
yalla fay
amen ya
rabbi barke sayidina muhammad alhamdulillah heureusement amna xamay bañu fay sama doom bañu la jang mo su mom tay mo su dem ke passal ci dem ñu
ram
ñu xamna ne mënuñu lo
mënuñu ko boy dañu ma dañuy def 4 km dañuy def dem
ñu wax wallahi tout propre barke sayidina muhammad li wax mom lolu yalla kesse mo la ko da fay billah wala mel ñaar def fi ka nek ni ka yaram do xamal noy def
non man ka sama yaram dafa daw
kéro fa li passé dama dama lan def ex suba tay bi dama gëna dama ti dama gëna nek
encore fajar 6h
mais xul li ñu sol ñu kok di ko xul
li mu am ñu am amna ko xamné tank bi day metti mënutul quoi dox dox sonal
mais da metti ñoy ba ñu bañ nak nak lay jàngé bu ñu bisé
mo tax ñu nak ci gëj bi ni
non
commencé na ñaanu ñu ci yalla dal mu ko
wa yalla baxna lo ko yalla lay fa lo ko yalla
lay ñu yobu midi mu indi len ngon mu jëli waat nak da ko ci ñaan mo ñu yobu auto baay non do wéx
yalla yalla fay
dem na ba gis principal ba ñoy
yalla dina la fay
amin amin yalla merci salif
yalla
la fay ok salam alaykum na ngeen defay naka wa dekk bi ñeppay jam alhamdulillah mën jam dina ko deg inshallah dina def fay ok salut salut
Grammarly does more than catch errors. With Grammarly, you can find really good.
Fasile, you know, I met in a very interesting way. I was actually in the US, and I asked my cousin to help me to find a house. Past 4 years prior, I was looking everywhere outside of Dakar in a small village where I can find a home, not far from Dakar, but not in Dakar. When I was told about Sindhu, I sent my cousin to come and a colleague at the time, and both of them, when they went to visit, they sent me the video of the first house. So when I saw the video of the house, I was very moved when I saw him walking around showing them the house, because he reminded me so much like my grandfather. So I automatically called my cousin and asked him, I called Hussein and said, who is the older man in the video? And he told me that he's the housekeeper at the house, and also the jardinier, the gardener. So I told him, we have to buy the house, and then we have to keep him until I come back. I don't know what it was. I think that there was maktub there, and there was an ultimate connection right away, that my life would be connected to his life.
My dad used to come home drunk every day and hit me. My mom
The interesting thing is when I first arrived, I felt bad that he had to work, so I didn't, because in our culture we always, you know, retire people earlier, you know, when somehow we work to make sure that our parents get rest and we take over the bills and families and stuff. So I told him, Pasila, you know, you can still have salary here, but you don't have to work, because you're like my father, you're my grandfather too, you are my khalifa. All of the means that you are like my guide here, you are my parent, everything. So I would not make my parents work, so I don't want you to work. I want you from now, I just get a gardener and you just be the boss of the house, of all of us. And he didn't say nothing to me, he just walked away and told me, okay, all right. But I didn't know he was upset. You know, he's upset. I didn't see him in the evening until the next day. He used to come at 6 in the morning, very early. That day he came, usually I come out and see him, say hello. He was kind of cold. But him and my cousin are very, you know, they joke and all that. So my cousin asked him, is everything okay with Pasila? He said no. He said he don't like that you told him not to work. The first time, him and I ever had something with this going on. I would say that's the first time I see him actually upset when I ask him not to work. Then I called him to come have breakfast with me. I said, Pasila, you know, right about I just want you to be okay. I want to make sure I will take care of you. I just feel bad that I'm young and I have to pay you to work. I don't want you to do that. You're like my grandfather. And he told me, my son, you know, the day I stop to work, you will lose me. That was very profound when he said that to me. You know, he said, said, what do you mean? He said, the first day, the day you make me stop working is the day that I will be gone to the cemetery. That was the end of it.
Man Mustafa Silala Tudu. Mangi judo dekuna jagle. Sama bay gañu ma yay gañu. Mañi bi bak sama kër ni jay. Ñu way dem ba wagu ne gu tuti la. Ba xawma dara. Sama ni jay yorma. Bima nek magam jim. Oh legi nak ma joge ma nek fo magam jim nawete na ma ñaari yoon. Salu bi ma ngi nawet ci ginaaw njabel deug bi ñu wax mbéro nak bi ma ngi nawet ci gossas gossas filas ma joge fa ñibsi bi ma joge de kawla xawma mbéro nak di ma jay sama gerte ma joge fofu dem Kaolack ma ngi nekkon quartier ndorom
ñu bari dañuy ñu gis nañ ko sax ci suñu dëkk yëpp dañuy téré market ndax ni ñuy lekk parfois day yaq seen santé yi mais nan nga def ba garder sa santé ba légui ya nga fay di liggéey
sama liggéey dama ko jàngé ci nguni motax buma waxé né da ngay tok noklu mané comme ci ngoni la mako jangé bi fima tollu ni sama direct wañé ci ni légui buma ko nok buma togué noklu ko rek ko du bax ci man ko duma ko du dara noklu du ko du ci na bobu la ma tam nak bi buma waxé né togal noklu ko mané ko mo ma tok noklu ko ma togué noklu ko ñu ngay ñak motax li may liggéey ma diko liggé amna way morom yo xamni ñu wéte dekk ba ma xarit bëni bakkan fi mu ne mëna tu dara
tay yéna ma surprise
waaw
bond music d'accord mémoire d'un éternel optimiste John Young. Chronique dans l'éternel optimisme. Ibsen, littérature.
Man moy conseil tay bo don joxe conseil xalé yi da nga len wax bo don digal xalé yi tay xalé yi may liggéeyal sa jaba yi sa doom yi ñoom useel lan nga len di digal bo don digal tay
dima len di digal dama leena wax ne premièrement nit bo nek ak mom ne fapatalo li ngay xoli lu mu bañ diko moytu lu mu bëgg diko def gëdd sa liggéey fonk sa liggéey da bu gëne kat nit di liggéey feñaat dede man yare ken yare wu ma ci feñaat damay liggéey day ba melni mbam nga damay fayé sama xol day xey kon nak boy liggéeyal koku da nga wel ni mbam te sun mom la len di wax bu fekké né da nga jang ben er be nga ay ay diplôme te yalla mayu la sax moy lo sax bo amé place bu ba bo jité mi né ba sax defal on dal len gën wara bañ yeen xalé Sénégal wu saté lolu gor du ko def way fo gis fo muy may dëreul mo ci jarign boy bo du ci jarign wa ni mel ni ma ci la ci ni nango ligé nango ñëpp te bay ala li jàng nango ligé bay ala li jàng il est là c'est bien. Tu as vu le Sénégal, tu as vu le Sénégal.
Il est là.
Ah.
budé budu Sénégal rek
budé Sénégal jami kay rek
kan la sunu
bu ma
ba ma
bu ma
Jup.
Before you skip this ad, I want to show you this map because this isn't just any ordinary map.
Thank you.
Baitafa is very, very special to me. He is my light, my motivation, but also he's the bridge of our past. And he keeps us going. He keeps the tradition for us, and that is very special to us. For example, every time I'm traveling overseas, no matter how late it is, he is not going home. He's waiting for me to come out. So he can pray and bless over me before I leave the house and the country. And that is deeply rooted to our culture, in our tradition. My hope for Baitafa is to live a longer life with us. You know, I wish for him he's the answer that I had for my grandfather's wishes. What I wish for my grandfather to be in his presence is here now. So I pray every day that he gets to see where we're going and what we're working for. I pray that he has continued to have strength, you know? It inspires me to basically to not have no excuse why I should be resting and to be pressing forward to the fierce urgencies of now, of the most pressing issues of our communities. It makes me almost guilty to have not done enough to bring solutions to some of the things that we're dealing with.
1,215. That is the number of units that this random product right here sells every single
My name is John Nyang. I am originally from Kaolack, Senegal. Kaolack is a city 3 hours away from Dakar. Dakar is the capital of my home country. I grew up in a large poor family of 28 brothers and sisters. A family, a polygamy family. And growing up through that family, very early on, I looked at my mother every morning and saw a beautiful woman, but very sad, with a lot of pain, having not to be able to feed her children, but also the competition in the house, going through to have to share your husband, and then the competition with the wives. This brought a lot of frustration to me very early. I moved on with my grandfather, a wise man, poor, but gave me all the wisdom that I needed in the world. The young age, at 16, I left to go to Dakar to finish my high school. Then I dreamed up to go to the United States. I wanted to go to America to make life better for my family, for my mother first, then my brothers and sisters. I heard of a country that maybe I can get an opportunity, but maybe my family don't have to call up a minister, or you don't have to have somebody who got money to make it. In 2000, after many tries of trying to get a visa, I got denied 4 times. And I finally landed in the Bronx, in New York, where I started cleaning tables, like many immigrants do when they come home, when they come here, working, try to make ends meet. The first thing was to get a job ASAP so I can make sure my mother is fine. In the Bronx, I did 3 months there cleaning tables, then I had to move to Cleveland, Ohio, because I had to go to school there. I started in a small community college with 2 jobs at the Marriott Hotel, cleaning tables and sending money home, try to do my payments in school, and try to just keep my head above the water. Somehow, through the mix of that in Cleveland, I got into teaching French on the side in a community school called International Preparatory School. That job has woken me up because it's in the east side of Cleveland where I found a lot of young African Americans, 14, 15 year olds, my students, going to jail in and out. I start asking myself, what can I do to make a difference in this great city that's already given me a lot? Because many of those young people are left with a single family, a single mother, trying to make ends meet with 4 jobs, taking care of them, and most of those young men don't have no mentor or role model. On top of that, I saw, if you remember 2003, 2004, that's when our economic meltdown happened in the United States. I saw some of my friends losing their homes in Cleveland. And if you know Cleveland, Ohio is where most of our jobs was coming from, those factories that were sent to China, to Asia. When most of those factories closed, people couldn't pay their mortgages, so many people lost their jobs. Again, I asked myself, what can I do? So I started volunteering in campaigns, city council members first, to help elected officials who can support, who can represent not only few, but a lot, or everyone. I started with city council members such as Kevin Conwell in the east side of Cleveland, 2 years volunteering, knocking on doors, not getting paid for it, to the mayor's campaign, to the senator's campaign, not knowing the importance of Cleveland or Ohio in American politics. I had no idea. So when you give sometimes, you might not see what you're going to receive till later, too many young people that are watching. So I got involved in the Young Democrats and became the first African-American to run the Young Democrats of the major county, Democratic county in Ohio. Then something happened when I was running a campaign for a state senator named Shirley Smith. She introduced me to Senator Obama in 2006. A few months later, the president wanted to run for office. I joined his campaign as a community organizer. Running around the country, running around the states, crossing America, try to elect a president that I believed can bring the change that I believed in. Something happened the day after inauguration. President Obama invited us in this room like this, to all of the staff members, in a staff ball, and he told us, what are you going to do now with all of this energy? It's because of you that I got elected as the first African-American president in the United States. Early mornings and late nights, you've put in a sacrifice, and he was right. The reason why I'm here. Now, what are you going to do with that energy? Some can come and help me bring the change we've promised to the American people in Washington, or even go around the world and help change the world. When he said that, I remembered growing up in Cowlack with my grandfather. God bless his soul, sometimes 4 days, 5 days in our house, we had no food. I lost him because of hunger. I remember he was sick for 5 days. We couldn't find rice to feed him. That's how I lost him. And I knew there's millions of young people across the world that night who will never have the opportunity that I had. From the time I lost my grandfather of hunger, to me sitting around the President of the United States, of helping to make history in our generation, is only 10 years. And I know there is young people out there who will never have that opportunity. I said to myself, what can I do to build these bridges? So there's millions of young people like me who grew up in poverty, who will never know when their next meal will come, who will never know when their next opportunities will come, who might be losing their grandfather also, or their mom, or their brothers or sisters of hunger, of energy, or lights, or nothing. I will help to do something about it. So from that night on, I was not looking to do many things. I just wanted to give a project to somebody, help somebody realize their dreams. So I started Give One Project. 6 years today, Give One Project is my foundation, my nonprofit. It is in 32 countries. From working with young people in Japan, to working with young people in El Salvador, in Guatemala. Those young people I met through there all the way to Mexico, who are just trying to get onto the beast, the train, that train they call the beast, to cross the dangerous borders, try to come to the United States of America looking for opportunities that you got. Many of them die across that border. Many of them, those women got raped. I met so many of them. And all they're looking for is opportunity. To those young people that I just met last month in Ceuta, in the border of Morocco and Spain, where young Africans across the continent are traveling to try to cross the ocean to go to Europe looking for opportunities. Last year was the deadliest year of young people we've lost in the Mediterranean Sea trying to go to Europe for opportunities. I met them there living in the bushes in so many difficult conditions that you cannot explain to somebody. So we are the lucky ones. You here in this room tonight are the ones, no matter how hard you work to be here, you are the lucky ones. We are. Because we have done anything that really made us to just be born in this side of the world, that we're not going through what people are going through across the world. Right now, if this stop working, the lights, or the mic, or you go home, there's no warm water, there's no light at your house. I want you to imagine, just for one day, you go home, there's no light there. You will be shocked and frustrated. But the news I'm bringing to you today is that billions of people across the world today are living in the dark. We'll never know what are the benefits of energy. In my continent, in Africa, 630 million people are living in the dark. Very recently, I was inaugurating a village in Mali, Kai, far down with my partner, Akon. And an old man got up and cried and told me, you know, because of your solar lights that you brought here, my children are able now at night to go outside under the light and study. That tells me right away that without lights, there is no education. There is no, without energy, you have no education. I went through it. I remember my grandfather used to wake me up early in the morning because that night before, he didn't have a quarter to buy a candle for me to be able to just do my homework. And very recently, we were in Benin with the Prime Minister, drove 4 hours away past Cotonou, Akon and I. And when we went to inaugurate, a lady got up and told us, I'm selling mangoes and fruits to support my family. I'm selling mangoes and fruits to send my children to school. Because of your lights, I can sell at night now till 9 in the evening. Before we got there, at 6 o'clock when the sun goes down, the economy stops. So when there is no energy, there is no economy. In the 5 villages of Kenya, Maasai villages that we electrified, women who at night, if they have to give birth, cannot go to the clinics because there is no lights. Told us the same thing. Remembering these stories is the essence of why in 2013, when my partner Akon came to see me in Washington in a gathering like this, where I had almost 200 young people from around the world in the White House, opening those gates for them so they can dream higher, to know they can do anything. Akon and I decided we're going to do something about the energy crisis in Africa to make life just a little bit better for some. Today, Akon Lighting Africa is in 16 countries in Africa, touching millions of families. And we wanted to do a little more than just giving lights. Job creation was important to us. So we opened up the first solar academy in Mali that is training young Africans. Because I remember us going to China and negotiating with our Chinese partners, and they tell us, you know, each country we're going to bring 200 or 300 workers. We say, well, I don't think that's the good idea, because 65% of young Africans are under 30 years old, and with no jobs, with no training. So we decided we're going to train them to do the work, to put the lights on, and then do the maintenance. Because of that decision, today we are 5,200 young people are working for us in the continent. Why am I telling you all these stories? I'm telling you these stories to tell you that the world is unequal. And this new generation, have to ask ourselves what kind of world that we want to live in. What kind of world that we want to leave for our children and our grandchildren. We can do something about it. We can do something about it by first starting in us. Each one of us is wealthy. Each one of us has something that's so special in you that if you touch it, if you acknowledge it, you find it in you, and then you convert it, you can not only amaze the world, but you can change the world. I was just a kid who thought somehow I have nothing. But I realized later that nothing I don't have is something to someone. And all of you, that something that you think you don't have is the greatest thing to someone looking for it. How can you take that something you think you don't have and convert it into the blessing, being a blessing to someone? That's the question that I want everyone to ask themselves. Why are you here? What role will you play? Because there is some we remembered in history, and we don't remember because of the cars they've driven, the degrees they had, the money they left in their bank accounts. There is a young man named Lee Kuan Yew at age of 36, took on his country, Singapore, with all the challenges that was left, and turned it into the Singapore that we know today. Benjamin Franklin was 36 when he was starting to write the Constitution of the United States of America. Nelson Mandela, at 31 years old, joined the ANC movement to liberate his country, which cost him later on 27 years of his life. Dr. King was only 22 when he joined the civil rights movement. Actually, he passed only at 39 years old with everything that he's done. There's something about young people changing the course of history, and young people with paradigm shift. If you look at history, everything that's changed has changed through young people. So if we want a better world for ourselves, or a better world for the children, our children and their children to come, the time has come now that we have to ask ourselves, what we are doing, is it really touching people? The work we are doing, is it participating in making life better for others, or is it only helping us? Because those who thought that it was only helping us or the no-sayers in the past, in the end, what we remembered was those who made the sacrifice to make life better for others, not the other way around. This is what might make my life work today. I believe the greatest investment one can make is in young people, because I believe they are the seeds that we need to water, who will end up giving us the fruits that we need. But young people of today, I will tell you what President Roosevelt said in his inauguration in 1933. He said to Americans, to young Americans, that this generation of young Americans has rendezvous with history. But this generation of young people here in Canada and across the world, we have rendezvous with history. And the question is, what will history say about us? Did we fight to make sure that we focus on our commonalities, celebrate our differences, focus on bringing us together and fighting to make sure the world is just a little equal? Because we're in a world where more than 1 billion people are living under $1. And when we go right now, somebody's gonna complain because they didn't get a job that they don't want. The things you take for granted, people are dying for. And who much is given, much is required. We can't continue to live in the world where just few people are doing well and the rest of the world are doing bad. I believe we all do well, then everybody will be good. But if few are doing well, we are all in trouble. This is why you see many young people can put bombs in themselves and just go and kill people just like that, because they have no hope. They've been in a position where they got nothing else to lose. We are stuck with each other because at the core, we share that human family, whether we want it or not. It is not the color of our skin that's gonna divide us. As much as we want, it's not gonna happen. You're not getting rid of none of us, we're here. It's not our economic backgrounds, because you got more money than the other, that's gonna divide us. Even if you want to, we are still stuck together. It's not because the other person come from these kind of families and the other one didn't. So this generation will have to answer the key question that tomorrow history will ask: what have we done for them? I know, and I'm grateful, that if it was not for the sacrifices of Rosa Parks and such like Dr. King and such, I will not do what I've done in the United States or around the world today. And I know President Obama should be knowing, if it was not those sacrifices, he wouldn't be here. We young Americans have sacrificed to put President Obama in office, not for him, but for us. But the question now is, what are we continuing to do to make sure that those generations coming after us will say, because of them, I'm here? This is my fight. And this is a fight of an eternal optimist who believe that somehow I will succeed in it. With my young people that I'm training in Canada here, with those young people that I'm training, giving opportunities in entrepreneurship and global leadership programs, in women empowerment projects all across Japan, in Mexico, in Senegal, in France, in Italy, across the United States. Those young people, I know and I'm sure that if I fail to make it, one or two of them will be able to pick up the fight and continue to give opportunities to more people across the world. Thank you. God bless you all. Thank you.